All right, a quick show of hands. How many of you have stood in front of the mirror, spotted a gray hair or a wrinkle, and been like, that's it, I'm officially ancient? That's a lot of you. One moment, you're dancing wildly late night at a concert, and the next moment, you're Googling, what are the best joint supplements? How to cure back pain? It's funny how most of us reach there way sooner than we would have liked to or we would have expected to, right? But aging, my friends, is not just about swapping your late night routines with early bedtimes or trading your skinny jeans with stretchy pants. Today, I am here to flip the script on what it is to age, aging like a pro, and aging in a most graceful manner. Now, growing up, my mom has been a source of resilience and strength for me. Life threw a lot of challenges at her, but she dealt with them in a more graceful manner than anybody else that I've ever met. And she retired 2 years back, entering into what a lot of people would call her twilight years. But if you go to her and ask her how she's doing, she'll tell you it's a whole new adventure for her, and she's more than happy to receive senior citizen discounts and special privileges. Now, listening to my mom, I realize that preparing to age in a graceful manner doesn't start at 60, doesn't even start at 40. It starts right here, right now, in how we choose to embrace life, in how we choose to take care of our health, and not just that, but also foster connections with each other and with the society. My extensive experience as a social change maker and my profession as a scientist for the last 12 years, studying fundamental science and understanding how the body functions in an inside-out manner, has introduced me to the paradigms of aging. And taken all my insights together, I have come up with a 5-hour framework on balanced aging. The society has conditioned us to see aging as a progressive decline or a loss of cognitive function, of motor function. However, what I want to, you know, ask you guys to think about and give you a food for thought is, why see aging as something that needs to be feared, and why not consider it as a process that can be embraced, understood, optimized, and even celebrated? We need to reframe the way we look at aging. And this draws insights from the recent scientific findings that have informed us of how and what aging actually is. I work at the Cluster of Excellence in Aging and Aging-Related Disorders, and during my PhD, I was a part of the Cologne Graduate School of Aging. For decades, scientists have been working tirelessly to understand the hallmarks of aging and the strategies to extend the lifespan or the longevity. How can you spend more years living? However, a major breakthrough, at least from a scientist's perspective, came when they stimulated the concept of a health span as opposed to the lifespan. Whereas lifespan refers to the number of years that you spend living, health span refers to the number of years that you spend in good health without chronic illnesses and in full functionality. And this was groundbreaking in how people shifted their perspective towards approaching aging. It was no more a problem that needed to be fixed, but it was a process that could be optimized in a way such that you can extend your health span. And this was or has been the focus of the researchers for the last 2 decades. Another breakthrough in the field of health span and aging has been the development of the idea of your biological age, as opposed to the quintessential concept of chronological age. When people ask you what your age is, you'd probably tell them the age on your passport or the number of years that you have spent living. But the concept of biological age gives you an inside-out perspective of looking at how your body is aging. It gives you a parameter that you can assess your cellular age in how your tissues are functioning. And mind you, as is very clearly evident in the picture that I have shown here, people who have chronological age of a 60 can have biological ages of a 45 or even 40. And that can be the huge difference because they have put effort and time into maintaining their body and making sure that their metabolic health is good. It's no more about external appearances, but it's more about how your functionality is. Now, I'll point a very interesting experiment that was done by scientists at UCLA for a span of 20 years. And this is the closest that you can go to humans in terms of research. This study was done on two rhesus monkeys, Canto and Owen. They were given different kinds of diets, and after 20 years of experimentation, these were the observations that were published. My question to you guys is, would you like to look like Canto or Owen, given a choice? Canto or Owen? Of course. But guys, this was a trick question. Didn't we just discuss that external experiences don't matter? External appearances may or may not be indicative of the biological age, but rightly said, Canto was biologically much younger than Owen. And scientists, after understanding the concept of biological age, have come up with a huge set of parameters. There have been consortiums where people have understood and developed tools like the epigenetic clock to help you predict your biological age with just a basic blood test. And this helps us come to the next R, which is to rejuvenate. But this time, from a lens of understanding your body inside out. Rejuvenation of the body often involves what we as scientists called the rectangularization of the health span. After decades of research, scientists have found out ways and strategies to help you extend your lifespan, rectangularize it, and reduce the rate at which your biological clock ticks, thereby allowing you to enjoy a youth-like experience even when you chronologically age. And this rectangularization of health span can be brought about by a beautifully summarized 5 pillars of healthy aging. The pillars start by you asking you to be mindful about the quantity, quality, and timing of nutrition that you take. Making sure that you take care of your physical body and you exercise enough to keep your joints moving, muscles acting, and your organs of the body functioning optimally. It also involves you allowing enough time to your body to repair and regenerate by giving yourselves timely sleep cycles at a duration that is needed for your body to rejuvenate. Lastly, you also cannot neglect that your physical health is intertwined with your mental health. Removing triggers that cause stress and anxiety can go a long way in helping you increase your health span. And lastly, it's not just about seeing aging from an individual lens, but fostering meaningful connections and developing a purpose in life can help you a lot in having a lower biological age. Now, all of these pillars, there is a theme that comes up when you listen to all the five agendas that I've talked to you about. There's a constant balance that is needed, balance between the body and the mind. The mind can affect how your body functions. And if your body is stressed, it can in turn be manifested as stress or anxiety. And this constant balance between maintaining the body and the mind is extremely crucial for extending your health span. Now, so far, I was developing these perspectives given my objective background in science and my engagement with the society as a social change maker. Until life decided to show me that there is yet another layer to our existence. It is not just about the body and the mind. And this was rooted probably, I didn't know that this existed in me, and this was probably rooted in the cultural oriental philosophical teachings that I had learned from my culture, which is the layer of the spirit or the layer of spirituality. The third R is a call for us to reinvent ourselves as we grow old or as we age. Growing old is often associated with a sudden change in priorities for people. The hustle and bustle to fend for a family, the active contribution to workforce no more exists, and this can lead to people questioning what their purpose is anymore of living. At that point, connecting to your life's calling or ikigai is extremely important. In a very traditional capitalist structure, we spend our lives trying to reach out for the maximum, getting ourselves the best of amenities and taking care of the people that we care about. We forget to connect to what our internal calling is. And mind you, you do not have to wait to age in order to connect to your purpose. There have been studies at the bridge of social sciences and fundamental sciences, and through personal interviews, people have reported that elderly people who had connected to their purpose or have had a purposeful living throughout their life have better mental health status, greater health span, and lower biological ages. Connecting to your purpose can happen right here, right now, in this room. Now, this concept of us hustling, trying to making things work, is a very outward perspective. But as we age, something inside us changes. It's like a call for us to turn our eyes inwards. It's like an invitation for us to embrace gratitude. It's like balancing the masculine and the feminine, not in terms of the traditional genders that we are used to stereotyping, but in terms of balancing a state of doing with a state of being. And this balance, once achieved inside you, can give you a feeling of completeness, a feeling of being whole. And this is one of the beautiful gifts that comes as you age, as you mature. And this is why it might sound ridiculous when I say it, but I cannot wait to age and become wiser. It gives you a zoomed out perspective on life. One of the biggest learnings that I had during my PhD was the art of letting go and surrendering to the unknown. Surrendering doesn't mean giving up. It just means you developing a perspective and the clarity that you can only control the controllable and you have to go with the flow with everything that's beyond your control. Maintaining this balance can go a long way in keeping your stress and anxiety levels low and maintaining a balanced state and a balanced approach, a graceful approach towards aging. This added spiritual layer to the personality makes you shine for sure, but also makes you realize the interconnectedness amongst all beings. Reconnection is my next R because so far we have discussed this new perspective on aging from an individual perspective. But aging is also a very important socio-economic and political concept. Social scientists, economists, and epidemiologists view aging as a community-based event because when a huge number of population is belonging to an age of above 60, of course, the amount of resources that have to be devoted to taking care of their health is more. And oftentimes, they're seen as a burden on the society. And this is what we call ageism. Scientists all over the world are advocating for fighting ageism and seeing the elderly as reservoirs of knowledge and wisdom and have them play an important role in not just the workforce, but also in the civic affairs. The WHO projects that by the end of 2025, the total number of elderly will be 1.2 billion. And with such a huge shift in demographics, it's very important to look at examples that have worked. The so-called blue zones, such as Sardinia in Italy or Okinawa in Japan, have the highest number of centenarians living in the world. And all of their elderly are super healthy. They have large health spans and very low biological ages. And scientists attribute this to the amazing policy-level, community-driven initiatives that are elderly-friendly. There is a constant exchange between people of different ages. Intergenerational allyship or intergenerational solidarity in these blue zones is something that has also been appreciated and commanded by the World Health Organization. And this forms a very important basis of changing a perspective and looking at aging from a new perspective at a community level. Now, all of these global shifts in perspectives cannot happen by just individual effort. So this 5R framework is also a call to the policymakers to introduce reforms that can be informed by the latest scientific and sociological changes in the paradigm of aging, and then have policy guidelines published for countries so that they can prepare well from a state of awareness. I'd like to bring your attention to a very interesting policy guideline on active aging that was published by the World Health Organization in 2002. And they had proposed three major pillars for active aging, which is participation, health, and security. It is a call to the policymakers or to the nations to ensure that the health of the elderly is taken care of by introducing or channelizing technological advancements into developing strategies to keep them healthy. More and better models of health insurance is yet another intervention that can help at a policy level deal with the growing curve of aging population. Likewise, better programs for caregivers and global exchanges of caregivers can go a long way in helping them. Strategies to make sure that there is enough participation of the youth in taking care of the elderly is also a strategy that can be groundbreaking. So all of these things taken together help us shift our narrative from fearing aging to embracing aging as something that can help us tap into an unknown version of ourselves that we probably didn't know existed, to a version that is more balanced, to a version that is more whole, and to a version that is more connected. With this five-hour framework, we deal with aging not just at the individual level, where the soul is the main driver and controls your body and the mind, and a balance between the left arm is extremely important, but it also views aging at a societal level, now where the individual is the driver. And then comes the policy, and then comes the community. And all of this taken together is a very tightly knit, beautiful gear system that needs to be put in place to deal with this shift in demographics and to deal with this change in perspective, a new perspective. My urge to the people here sitting in the audience is, the next time you walk into a store, do not look for an anti-wrinkle cream, but look for and embrace your wisdom serum. And before I end the talk, I would like all of us to feel the connectedness and the energy together and say with me the 5-hour aging mantra. Age with power, age with grace, live with wisdom, set the pace. Once more. Age with power, age with grace, live the wisdom, set the pace. One last time from the core with your hands up in the air. Age with power, age with grace, live the wisdom, set the pace. Thank you.